Hello, everybody, and welcome to Schwab Coaching. My name is Lee Bull. I am one of the education coaches here at Schwab. I'm being helped today in the chat by Big Ben Watson, the chart master. So he'll do well to answer all of your questions, I am sure. Today's topic is advanced charting. The question I have for you is, we look at advanced the decline lines. We looked at the McClellan oscillator, but did you know that there's yet another McClellan type indicator to check the overall market? We shall cover that today. All right, before we do though, we have our usual logistical items. So remember, everything we are doing today is for educational and informational purposes only. Nothing is a recommendation. We will be using individual stock symbols. They are to illustrate concepts and functionality, and again, are not recommendations. Also, we're talking about technical analysis, obviously, in advanced charting, but we don't recommend the use of technical analysis as your sole method of investment research. We have access to the paper trading function on thinkorswim. If you're using that, please just keep in mind that results in thinkorswim don't always translate the way you might think to real-time trading. And finally, we're not including commission or transaction costs in today's session. All right, so our agenda is we are going to look for different technical indicators and patterns. We will discuss the pros and cons of them. But most importantly, of course, we'll just look at examples on charts, which will be most of our discussion today. So let's go take a look at some charts and get right started. All right, so we have a chart here of the New York Stock Exchange composite. You'll see why I'm using that in just a moment. But remember, we had the employment figures today, 190,000-ish kind of met expectations. The wage growth was a little bit more than expected. So the interest rates are ticking up just a little bit today based on that. But what we do, let's take a look at the S&P 500 before we move into this chart, although they're kind of similar. All right, so what we have here is an inverse head and shoulder that we broke out of, and now we have done a little bit of a flag, or at least a horizontal consolidation. It was looking more like a flag in here. We did take that out, but then we came back after that and made a low in this pullback. We are now above the, we had a close yesterday above the low of the, above the high of the low day, I should say. So some people think that is a positive situation. But remember, when we look at markets, we want to look at other things just for price, because we want to know the market internals and different ways to look at them. So that's where we're going to start today. All right. So we talked a couple of weeks ago about the McClellan oscillator. And just for those that didn't see that class, or for those who are not familiar, I'll just quickly review that, because we will need that today to look at another indicator. So this is the advance to decline line. You all know probably about the MACD indicator, right? It's a momentum indicator where you compare two moving averages. If one moving average starts pulling away from another one, so the faster moving average starts pulling away from the slower one, means perhaps an uptrend is getting a little bit more momentum. So what the McClellan oscillator is exactly that concept, but the underlying data that it's using is not the price of an index, rather it is the value of the advance to decline line. Okay, so that is what the McClellan oscillator is. It's a MACD of the advance to decline line. You can use it just like a MACD. In other words, there's three ways you can use it, right? You can just use zero line crosses. And let's just take a look at a couple of them. We crossed above zero here. For some traders, that might have been, you know, you don't just use market breadth as a signal, but it does allow you to confirm price action. So in here, we had a good surge in market breadth, and very soon afterwards, you know, the market took off. And some traders get out of a trade they initiate with the McClellan oscillator if it drops below zero. So you can just put it on a chart and see how it's done vis-a-vis any index that you are looking at. So we know about that. So what is it telling us now? Well, the last signal, if you use this technique, that this indicator gave was a buy right in here. And it is continuing to be in positive territory at the moment. Again, that's a buy for some technical traders. Not everybody uses it that way, right? The other way you can use it, if you want to be a little bit more, you know, drill in a little bit, you can use it for divergences, just like you can do a MACD divergence. Now, having said all of that, the McClellan oscillator typically is a short to intermediate term signal. It doesn't last for, you know, months and months at a time. Okay, so it's for shorter term trading. However, the McClellans, Sherman McClellan and his wife, came up with another indicator based on the same type of activity. And let us go find it, put it on the chart, and see how it's derived and what it tells us. All right. So we're going to go here to studies. At studies, we're going to look for McClellan. And what we're going to talk about now is the McClellan Summation Index. Okay. So we're going to add this to our toolbox when we are looking at market internals. So I'm going to put this on the chart. All right. Notice, okay, that again, it has a zero line, but what is it? What it is simply the sum total of constant readings of the McClellan oscillator. So if the McClellan oscillator continues to be above zero, this is going to go up. If the McClellan oscillator is below zero, every time it's below zero, it will take the value and decrease it a little bit. This does not happen overnight. This is a longer term signal on the market. All right. So now the question is, if you use it, sometimes you give quite a bit back if you're using it as a zero line cross. All right. So for instance, in here, it's, you know, it's crossing, and that was, you know, considered a, you know, a positive signal on the market, and we had a nice rally, but look how we gave a lot of it back, right? So one way to make it a little bit more useful and perhaps not give as much back is doing this. So we're going to click on this indicator, hopefully. All right. And what we're going to do, remember, it is like a MACD. So what we're going to do, instead of plotting it, okay, as a line, we're going to plot it as a histogram. Okay. So that I'm going to make it a little bit thicker so we can see it. And now I'm going to apply it to the chart. All right. So now we have the histogram. So just like a MACD histogram, what you can use it for is watch the histogram. So here we went to a positive value. The histogram went positive. And that was, for some traders, a little bit more of a bullish signal. But notice when the histogram started falling, some traders would use that as an exit signal. Okay, so you don't give as much back. So what is it telling us right now then? Well, McClellan oscillator is positive and the histogram is still growing, but maybe it's losing just a little momentum. We're going to have to see on that. So this is McClellan summation index. And you can see it gives longer term signals, more for the longer term position and almost investing time frame is what people use it for. All right. Now, if you saw my Twitter post, I want to show you one more indicator that you can use to confirm, at least get a feel for, I should say, what's going on in the market too. And this one is also developed by the McClellans, but this time it's developed by their son, Tom McClellan. All right. And it has to do with the VIX. All right. So I'm going to change my layout here so we can talk about this one. If you had followed me back when we were doing charting the markets, which was our market overview webcast before we went into coaching, I showed this indicator a lot. So a lot of people might be familiar with it. For those of you who aren't, you might find this a little interesting. So what we're going to do is I'm going to change my layout here. And we're going to go here. All right. So what is all of this? Look at all those lines. What the heck is going on here, right? All right. So let me get you oriented. I am charting the VIX. I am charting the VIX on a daily chart. Number one, all right? Because some of our market indicators, remember, like our Hindenburg Omen, if you follow that one, you have to do that on weekly charts. But this particular indicator, you do on daily charts, all right? So we have the VIX. What are these lines? Well, these are actually Bollinger Bands, but with a twist, all right? So let us go into this indicator and take a look at it. All right. So there's a couple modifications here that maybe you want to use this. All right. So let's start. I'm going to ask a question for all of you, and you can chat in the answer. What are the default parameters for Bollinger Bands? What moving average does it use? And how are the upper and lower bands set? And what I mean by that, how many deviations, standard deviations of price do you put the bands around whatever moving average you choose? And we're talking about the default. All right. So the default is, you can send it in, but I shall tell you because there's a little bit of a lag here. The default parameters on Bollinger Bands is the length of the moving average is 20. Okay, and the upper deviation is set two standard deviations above, and the lower one is set two standard deviations below. Okay, yes, Truth has got it, 20 and 2. Very good, guys, very good. However, you notice this is different, isn't it? So you can obviously set whatever moving average you want and whatever deviations you want. Now, we have changed the moving average based on research that Tom McClellan did. We've changed the moving average length from 20 to 50, okay? And we have dialed down the deviations. Instead of two standard deviations above, we set it to one standard deviation above. And the lower band is set one standard deviation below, all right? All right. Now, you can color your lines. Remember, on this type of indicator, the midline is the moving average, all right? And I don't show that. You can if you want, all right? But I think it makes it a little bit harder to see. Now, some people do that because it is often true that many technical traders, if you are using Bollinger Bands, let's say in an uptrending market, a lot of traders will look for, when you are like walking the upper band, a pullback to the middle band, which is the 20-day moving average, which is for some technical traders, a signal if it starts bouncing off that 20-day moving average. So what I did, but that's not how we're going to use this, all right? So we just want actually to look at the upper band, but I'm going to leave them both on there. And notice then we have a 50 period moving average, one standard deviation, and we're not going to show the middle band and then the lower band. All right. I have it purple and with three in the upper band. Okay. Purple again with three, apply that. All right. What are we looking for here? So Zinc 560 has a question. Did I set this up manually? Yes. Now you could make this an indicator, but it's so easy just to set it up from the default on the Bollinger Band. So that is what I did. All right. So what are the signals? Well, we kind of know, don't we, that when the market tends to trend higher, let me ask you a question. What does volatility often do when markets are trending up nicely? Volatility tends to drop, right? But that's not exactly what we're doing here. We are looking for lower volatility, but what we're doing is looking for sustained levels of lower or higher volatility. All right. What is this indicator called? It is Tom McClellan's VIX indicator. Okay. All right. So I have some lines on this chart. The signals that some traders use, not everybody, again, we're just giving you ideas. Okay. The way that this indicator is often used is you look for a major change of slope of the upper Bollinger Band. Okay. So here we have a three-year chart. Let's just look at some of the signals and how you get them. So we're looking for the upper band. And when it starts dropping, that's telling us that probably volatility is dropping on a more sustained basis. So that is a change. That's a pretty good change in slope, isn't it? So it started dropping all the way to here. What did the market do when we got that drop? Well, it looks, at least in this particular example, you know, it gave us a bullish signal. Not everybody uses it that way, but certainly you can see some signals here. The opposite signal, of course, would be when you get a sustained increase in the upper band. Okay, so that really kind of started here. Now, it is a bit of an art, just like all technical analysis, where you consider that you get a major move in the band. So yes, it went up in here a little bit, but not very much. But this was a big jump higher, wasn't it? Okay. And it continued to go up until it had a very big drop right in here. What did the market do when the slope was up? Yeah, the market dropped. Right here again, you're not really getting a very big one. This is more of a sustained drop in that upper band, and we had a rally in the market there. I've just put a couple other signals on there, but you can go back further and do it yourself. So this just gives you three. Now I'm giving you three or four different ways to add to your market analysis, right? You would use them all together, at least some traders do, and you're getting inputs from different types of internals on the market, right? So the McClellan oscillator and the McClellan summation index, right? That's giving you information on the health of the market from an advance to decline market breadth perspective. This one is giving you indications on the volatility situation in the market, also to give you a different viewpoint. And then, of course, you add that into price. So that's just three different inputs that you can use to help your market timing maybe just a little bit. Again, you wouldn't act on the signal by itself. It's just something you put in the back of your mind. So that gives us then some different things to look at. All right. So I just wanted to add that into our toolbox. So I try to give a overall market indicator at the beginning of this. All right. So down here, this was the S&P 500, if you didn't see that, just to show you what the market did with these different signals. All right. Now we have truth will always prevail. I love that handle saying this is a longer term indicator. Absolutely it is. It just gives you kind of the backdrop. Yes, it's you wouldn't swing trade or, you know, day trade on this indicator. Absolutely, that's correct. All right. All right. So step number one. Step number two, let's just go back and look at how our other trades have done. Now, I was off last week, but the trades that we have done in this class before, let's just take a look and see how we're doing there. And then what we're going to do is talk about a screen and go over how that screen is set up and what the reasoning is behind it. And maybe we can find the candidate to do yet another trade. All right. We have a question from Alan. Let me get that. So the question is, let me just read it for a second. Okay, looking at these indicators, the markets look to be more moving sideways short term. Christmas Mali to take effect last week of the month through New Year's. Yes. Now, if you look at seasonality, often, and again, there's no absolutes, often the market goes a little sideways in the first to second, the end of the first week to like another week, and then a little bit of the next week in December. It goes sideways or has a little bit of a downward bias. But what is the Santa Claus rally, right? The Santa Claus rally is defined as, you know, between Christmas and New Year's plus the first 2 days in January. All right. So that is the Santa Claus rally. So yes, it does tend to go sideways a little bit, at least historically, before you get a Christmas rally. And again, you don't get a Christmas rally every year, but get that. All right. Let us go take a look at a scan that I use quite a bit and other traders use a bit. It's not very hard, but it's simple. And we'll see what we get. So let's go here to the scan tab. All right. And what we're going to look for is this scan. Let's look at what it's doing first. All right. So let's just look at each of these components. The simple moving average that has a 15-day length. That's 3 weeks, isn't it? 15 days, that's 3 trading weeks. It is greater than the simple moving average that's 50 days, all right? Now, one thing that some traders do, if you are looking for, let's say, moving average crosses, this is just as an aside, I'm just trying to share with you some, not rules of thumb, but thoughts that some technical traders use. If you're doing moving average crosses, for instance, a lot of traders like to use moving averages that are a half or a third. The faster one should be a half, or could be a half or a third of the longer term one. And that's what we kind of have here. This is about, right? This is about a third of this. So we're looking for a faster moving average. It would have crossed and now it's above it. So maybe that means that there is an intermediate, a short to intermediate term uptrend in place. Now, if you are a longer term trader, you could lengthen those moving averages. If you were a shorter term trader, you could shorten them, right? And one thing to keep in mind is maybe you use the second moving average, the faster one, again, a half to a third of the longer one. Okay. So this is giving us some sort of uptrend. We always want to go with a trend, hopefully, at least some traders do that. But we want something that's maybe moving, maybe breaking out. And how are we going to get that? All right. Well, you all know perhaps about the RSI, right? The RSI is a momentum indicator. And it simply compares, you know, where we are in our own recent trading range on a stock or an index over a certain period of time. It kind of averages the total amount of up moves over a certain period of time, that certain period of time being the look back period. And then it looks at the downward progress that the stock has made in down periods, and it kind of averages that together. And that's what the RSI is. So if the RSI, looking back 10 days, has a greater value than the RSI looking back 30 days, well, what does that tell us from what I just said? It just tells us that the shorter term momentum is stronger than the longer term momentum. So could that, now we're already in an uptrend, aren't we, from the first filter. So now we got an uptrending stock that is perhaps increasing its momentum on the upside. So that for some bullish traders might be something they could look at. What is the next one? Well, again, price is the most important part of technical analysis, but volume is also important, especially for traders that like to trade breakouts. Many traders like to have increasing volume if the stock is beginning to pick up momentum and break out. So how did we do that? Here's what we did. We said the average volume for the last week, but we're not including today. Because remember, if we included today and we were early in the day, then there wouldn't be a lot of volume, right, in the beginning of the day, right? So we want more sustained volume coming into this as well. And we don't, so we take out today's volume. So we do the 5-day volume, not counting today, is greater than the average trading volume for the last 20 days. Okay. So what does that mean? It means over the last week, there has been more volume coming into the stock than there has been over the last month. Again, not a guarantee that that volume is going to push up the stock, but it's something to consider, isn't it? All right. Yes, I will post the screen link in a moment and show you how to answer it and all that. But let's finish going over it. But that excellent question. And then just because price is important, what we say is the close is yesterday was the highest highest had over the last 20 days. Okay. So let us screen this against an S&P list, the S&P 500. All right, so we're going to scan in there, and we're just going to hit scan. And we got several. So let us look at some of these and maybe try to decide between them just using some charts and maybe some secondary indicators. So let us start with USB. I want to look at this one because when I ran this prior to these guys were all on there prior. I ran this prior, right, to our session. But this one has popped up since then, so I don't know what this one looks like. So let's take a look, see what it is. And then I'm going to show you a couple that some traders might find interesting. But I want to look at this new one just for myself because I use this screen all the time. All right. All right, so let's go here to charts and look at USB. So we are going to switch our workspace here just to get a clean chart. All right, we're gonna put in USB. So what do we see here? Okay, couple of things. This kind of looks like a little flag. This one also looks like a flag. This one is a flag. So that's three flags in a row that we might be breaking out of. Now, the question when you're doing flags is the flag breakout going to run into any resistance to make the measured move first? So the way we need to look at that, okay, is we are going to be where resistance might be. Again, some traders might think it's right here and it could be breaking out. You know, we would probably want to look closer to the end of the day, but it's kind of interesting. What else do we see? Well, we saw it made a bottom, right? Was this in double bottoms? There's two ways that, right, Crispy is saying this is after a double bottom breakout, correct? Since we're talking about double bottoms, I want to give you two things that you can look at to try to evaluate double bottoms, all right? The first is we need the RSI. So we're going to put that on the chart. And I'm going to keep it at the default period of 14, all right? All right, so the first thing we would like to look at is compare the two bottoms. All right, also these bottoms have names. This is kind of a slope bottom, as is this one. It's not very sharp. So this is sometimes called an eve bottom, where if it's really sharp, the first one, and then the second one is more cup-shaped, that's called a Adam Eve bottom, okay? All right, so what do we see here? We got interesting matching lows, but the RSI was higher on the second one. Now, a lot of us know that that type of divergence sometimes can increase the odds that the second low might hold. The other way to look at the second bottom to see if it is has a better chance, I should say, to hold, is we're going to use the Bollinger Bands, and this time we're going to use it a little bit differently, right? I showed you how that Tom McClellan used those Bollinger Bands to do it on the VIX. We're going to use Bollinger Bands just on the price level here. And so what I'm going to do also is take off everything, because I just want to make a point, and we don't need too many lines on this, right? So I'm just going to remove all studies real quick, and now we're going to put on Bollinger Bands. There we go. No, come on there. There we go. All right. The other thing we might want to look for, I'm going to zoom in here now, is what is the behavior of the Bollinger Bands at that second bottom. Okay. So this was the first low, and we see it's kind of touching the Bollinger Band. How about the second low? Where is it versus the lower Bollinger Band? It's well off of it, isn't it? Now, the classic technical signal for some traders is when the first low is outside of the band and the second is in. Why might that be a signal for some technical traders? What it means is the momentum on the second low, remember this is deviations of price, is not as severe as the first time it made a low, which could mean for some technical traders that the selling is a little bit less at that second low. So this one is almost in the spirit of that. You know, it would have been a little stronger if this tail had gone out of here, below here. But we also notice this is pretty far away from that Bollinger Band. So for some traders, that might have been a tradable double bottom. Now, how do you generally enter a double bottom? Well, the classic way, of course, is you take the trade once it does the W. But with the Bollinger Band method and the RSI method, you can look for the low, and then you just look for a bar where you look at the low of the pullback, and you get a close above that high of that low day. You could have, based on that, you would have entered perhaps somewhere in here, okay? But that's not what we're looking for on this chart. I just wanted to do that because we had a question about double bottoms. So this one, we see it is breaking out of a flag. So that means we may not have resistance up there. Let's go back a little bit. So some traders might perhaps see that, but it's not, you know, it's still right around there and it's early. So this has some positives, but let's take a look at another one. So let's go take a look at our scan again. And let us, what was on that scan before was also GM and Wells Fargo. I can run it again here. Oh, the wrong scan, sorry. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is give you guys this scan, okay? Because I'm gonna load it again. So we're gonna go here to Most Grand Courier Personal, and this is uptrend breakout with increasing volume. Okay, and now I'm going to share scan query. All right, now we'll just say uptrend break out. Okay, all right, so I'm going to click share, and when you click share on here, this is the URL, and I can just paste it, all right? So I'm gonna paste it in the chat. So if you want it, you can have it. There it is, all right? Now, what I wanna do is change it to the S&P 100. I will say that if you use it, it sometimes it takes a longer time, and sometimes with 500 stocks, you know, it may be a little slower. So some traders might look at a smaller list, again, like the S&P 100, and we'll do that. And here's the ones we had before, right? Let's look at another one, FedEx. All right, so we have another breakout here. This one, we're a little bit higher above the resistance level. And what do we have down here? Is that earnings or? Yeah, so earnings are coming up. So you got to keep that in mind. So that's another couple of weeks. But perhaps, you know, this might be ready to move a little bit. Another thing that some technical traders do, all right, is let's look to see. Let's go back a little further, right? Let's go to the weekly chart real quick. Just make sure there's nothing hanging up there. So this is below this level. So really the next high in here is 319, all right? So maybe some traders could use that as a potential target, okay? So I throw that in there as well, just to look for that also. The other thing we could do is just see if there's a secondary volume pattern that is developing. Let's look at on balance volume too. Let's see if that'll give us more any indication than the raw volume bars. Okay, now we know that the volume has been higher the last few days than it has been over the last month, because that was in the screen. All right, so let us go and put out on balance volume and take a look at that too. And we don't really have a glaring divergence. Now, this line, based on today's volume and being up, will probably go up. So it's right around where it was. It's certainly not going the other way along with the price. Okay. So this is really not, for some technical traders, this wouldn't be something that would keep them from doing it, perhaps. Now, we saw that 319, okay, could be, based on a longer term chart, something that we can do. Let's go to the daily chart and check the on balance volume too. So the longer term volume pattern looks okay. And then let's look at, and again, it's going the right way as well. And it's right about where it was in here. So we're not really getting a huge divergence, maybe a little, but not huge. So how would somebody set up this trade? We're, you know, again, an example trade. This isn't a recommendation, but some traders might use a low of some sort. You know, if we're going for 319 from here, that's about what? 28 plus, that's almost 40 points. So we could risk maybe 10 points, okay, and take a look. If we risk 10 points, where would that be? That would be 272. Yeah, let's just go a little bit under the 20-day moving average. All right. So we'd be risking then 272 down to, what is that? 258. Yeah, so let's say 257. All right, so there would be the stop, and the target might be 319. All right, so let us do 30 shares or something. So what we'll do is buy custom with a stop. All right, so let's put in 30 here. All right, so we'll go ahead and we're going to buy it on a market order. Okay, and the sell will be a stop. And we said about 258. We'll make that good till cancel. All right, let's confirm and send that. All right, so let's just look at this trade. So we're doing this trade based on this screen as a breakout trade. Okay, so we are not, we got this backwards. Let's do it again. There we go. So we'll do this 30. We can actually put in the bracket if we want this time. 30, 30, 30. So again, our stop is going to be 258. All right, we'll go in at the market and just buy it. And if we wanted to do the limit for, so we need this one, this would be the limit, I'm sorry. So make this 319. And then the stop will be 258. All right, so that stop would be good till canceled. The limit would be good till canceled. Confirm and send this. All right. So let's see what we're doing here. We're buying 30 shares, and our target, we based that on a previous high, all right? But our stop, we're putting, so we have a positive risk to reward, and also we're using a little technical analysis there, our under the 20-day moving average we decided there, right? So remember with market prices here, that we don't know exactly where we're going to get filled at on the buy, and we actually don't know exactly where we're going to get out, even if it hits our stop, because that is a market order. All right, so let's click and send that. And we've got that going there. All right. All right, let's take a look at another one on our, actually, you don't have time to take a another one. We'll just do that one. We're going to take one quick look at the other one that was on there. Let's take a look. Wells Fargo is on there, too. Let's just take a look at that one real quick. We don't have time to do a trade on that one, but Yeah, so this one is breaking out of a flag, and it's also, but this one, you know, you got a high up there, right? That is kind of right above there. So maybe some traders would want it to take out that high also before they would get in. And our time is up, so let's just go see what we talked about here. So we looked at some charts, and then we showed you a couple of technical patterns and a couple of indicators, both on the market and just a scan. And then we discussed some pros and cons of those technical indicators, and we looked at examples on the charts. And once again, technical analysis shouldn't be your sole method of doing research. Also, everything I showed you is not a recommendation. We just did an example trade, and we didn't include commissions or stocks. So what I'll do again, we want to repost that scan again. I can do that for you. All right, so I just put it in there again. So I want to thank you for your kind attention. I hope you all have a great weekend. And I look forward to seeing you the next time we give this class. So thank you very much, everybody. Take care.